morning, so don't rush up after service. We have Father's Day donuts and there's coffee outside. That wind is a little bit chilly, so it'll warm you up. Get that sweet tooth sorted out. Do we have any newcomers with us this morning? Anybody? Newcomer? Don't you really disappear? I don't know if you're going to be standing outside. Thank you. Got a disc for you there. And just something we'd like you just to fill in if you don't mind. I had the privilege of hearing a story this week that will be sent to me. I'd like you to share. Would you share that with us quickly, please? Tell the story nicely.
Hi, people. I think first, I'd like you all just to look up and say Happy Father's Day.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah.
Amen. You should do it every day. Is the volume all right? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Is there anybody here that has not seen the painting of the Last Supper? Or at some stage have seen pictures of it?
Yeah.
All right. Now, the whole thing about that was it was done by a guy, Leonardo da Vinci. He was an absolute genius. He was an inventor, artist, philosopher. In the 1400s, the end of the 1400s, I think about 1480 or so, well, he was commissioned to actually do this painting of the Last Supper of Christ with his disciples. Now, he was a perfectionist. There is so much, even today's story, you've all heard about the Da Vinci Code, all goes back to this painting and the artist in it. And he was commissioned to do this painting, so the first thing that he did is he said, okay, he needs models. Who's going to look like the people that's going to be there? And he found the Jesus model in the chapel, or the cathedral that they had. He was a choir guy over there. And he got him and he modeled to start on the painting, because what he wanted to do was the reaction of the disciples when he told them that there's a traitor in the midst who's going to get him to be killed as such. And he went through, got to Jesus, and then in the next 11 months he got the faces of people that he thought represented the different disciples of what he thought they looked like. But then he couldn't find a Judas. And it took him years to finish it because he couldn't find this Judas. The picture of a guy that looked like Judas was his impression of it. And eventually, after a couple of years, he found a guy walking out of prison over there. He had shifty eyes. He was in there for murder. Was theft, and he just looked at hard face, hard mouth, his whole body language was arrogance, was aggression in it. And he approached the guy and he said to him, won't you please be a model, because you look like what I think Judas should look like. And the guy agreed, and he went. And they sat there, and after about 2 hours, this guy started crying. Really weeping. And he said, Da Vinci said to him, well, tell me, did I say something? Why is it? And he said to him, Master, don't you recognize me? A couple of years ago, I sat here as a model for Jesus. Now, the story is not true, but the message behind it is, and this story has been going for the last 500 years. But that in each of us there's a bit of Jesus and a bit of Judas. And it's for us to try and get every day that the Jesus comes out stronger than the Judas. Now if you look at it, a baby, newborn baby, total innocence. Right? You all know it, they look beautiful. And if you look at it, any murderer, any thief at one stage also was a baby. But it was wrong choices and the wrong examples of people that actually made them do that art. Now, I can ask you this. If you look at your own soul picture of yourself, where do you think of Da Vinci would have put you? In the place there on that picture? Or would we have been there at all?
Thank you. The same question came to my mind when I heard that message. Is which one are you feeding? Are you feeding your Judas? Or are you feeding the Jesus inside of you? Because as that story goes, you can see where the Jesus would take you and where the Judas would take you. So which one are you feeding? That's my question to you this morning. We'll leave you with that as we enter into praise and worship. Won't you all stand as we sing what a glorious day it is.
Thank you. share their blessings with others like you. Luke 6 verse 38 says, give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over, poured in your lap. Whatever the amount you give is determined by what you will get back. In Jesus' name.
Greet your friends.
Amen.
No hugs. Just saying thank you to our Heavenly Father. The F is for all the things that God leads us through and that He teaches us in our lives. The A is for promising me that He will never leave me. The T, through and through, He's shown us the ropes. H, for helping me in everything that I can face each and every day. He is for every day that He's there for us. And He's calling our name. And oh, rarely do I get to say thank you enough. So on this special day, on this special morning, can we just take just a moment? And just as we start to raise our eyes to the heavens and just say, Lord, Father God, thank you. Thank you for being a good, good Father. Thank you for being there for us each and every day of our lives, even when we don't see you. God, you're not some far away God that we don't see. You sent Jesus to die on the cross and now He lives within us. You're a God within us. You're a God around us. You're a God in everything. You're in the air that we breathe. And we thank you for being the ultimate good, good Father this morning. Amen. If you have your Bibles with you, why don't you turn with me to Genesis 18, from verse 18 to 19. Since Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him, for I know him. In order that he may command his children and his household after him, and that they keep the way of the Lord and do righteousness and justice, that the Lord may bring Abraham what he has spoken to him. And that should stand, what should stand out in that scripture to you this morning is that he says, for I have known him. God is saying, I know him. I know him. The reason I picked this man, the reason that I am starting a new covenant with this man, the covenant that would ultimately bring us the Messiah, Jesus Christ. The reason I'm starting a covenant with this man, Abraham, is that I know him. And I know that he will command his children to walk in the ways of the Lord. He knows this man. Guys, the father is the dominant figure in the home. And he plays a very vital role. And there's more than just being a man. There's more than just to being male than being a man. You can be male and you can not be a man. You can be married and you can not be a husband. You can be a breeder and you cannot be a father. There's more to being a man than just having a zipper on your pants. The Bible teaches us that a dad, the father, is the male dominant figure in the home. And that he is to lead his family in a spiritual life. Something that really touched me when I was preparing this message this week. If you think that one third of the children in this nation are illegitimate, and more than half of the children in this nation are reared or raised without a father figure in their home, it's with that the scripture that we read this morning makes so much more sense. More than 25 million children today are growing up without a parent, without a father figure in their home. More than 25 million children today are fatherless on Father's Day. And I'm not talking about people who've been through divorce where the father figure is still active in those kids' lives. I'm talking about where there's no father involved at all in those kids' lives. More than 25 million children are growing up in a home without a dad. And this is one of the greatest tragedies that I believe that our society faces today. And one of the greatest afflictions that can happen to a child in their life is to be raised without a male fatherly influence in that child's life. The only thing worse than having a home without a father is having a father that does not play the right role. And that's not the right role model in that home. That's leading his kids in the wrong direction. When you hear scriptures like the Apostle Paul talks about, and he teaches us that we have many teachers, but not many fathers. You'll have a lot of people in your life that you will learn from, but no one can take the place of a father. A man who does not provide for his family, the scripture says in 1 Timothy 5 verse 8, but if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Another translation says he's worse than an infidel. If you don't provide for your family, if you don't take care of your own family, God's word in the New Testament teaches us that your religion is then warped. Because it begins in the home. It begins in the family. The responsibility of a dad, guys, cannot be overstated. The leadership to be a dad and the father and the parent in the home, and so I'm speaking to single mothers too, you've got a calling over your life. You've got such a great responsibility that God has called you to stand up, because you need to play that figure in your kids' lives. And it comes to you with a tremendous responsibility to give affirmation and spiritual direction to those kids. You are the priest of your home. You are the priest of your home, and that's what I'm going to call you to this morning. I'm going to speak out of my heart this morning a little bit as well. And I want to honor my biological dad this morning. And those of you who know him will remember that he was what a great man he was, and he led my sister and I wherever he was able. He might not have shown it all the time, but I know that near the end we had him saved and we had him baptized, and I know that he had a relationship with the Lord. But my dad was like an onion. You had a peeling back layer by layer. He was a man of great stature, but he had this tough outer skin. But on the inside, he had a heart of pure gold. He was a man of great influence. And what I'm going to speak into each and every one of our lives this morning is we need to be people. We need to be men, women, fathers, mothers, husbands, and wives. We need to be people of influence. We need to influence our kids. Guys, those kids are like sponges. I know mine are 5 and 4, those of you that know. And I know there's quite a few of us with young kids in this room this morning. Grandfathers, you've got those little ones. I know grandfathers have this thing. They want to influence the kids and send them back to their parents. But what I want to say to you this morning is we need to install an influence in those kids that they can take home. And we need to build up their spirituality. It's our responsibility to lead them to Jesus. God said, I know Abraham, and I know he will teach and he will lead his children and command them in the way that I command them to go. He understands his place of authority in the home. And he is the head of the house. He is the father of influence. And God said, that's the kind of man that I am looking for. You see, when you're a father, when you're a father of prayer or a mother of prayer, it's like you're putting a spiritual roof over your house. Can you imagine living in your house, the house that you're living in right now? Can you imagine living in your house and having all your nice things and your couch and your TV and all those things we have in our homes and not having a roof over your house? Can you imagine? And it's the same, that's what prayer does in our homes. Prayer puts a roof over our house and it protects our homes from spiritual evilness. And we put a spiritual roof over our house. When we pray as a family and we take a few minutes just to open up our Bibles and read it and pray together, that's what it does. It puts a roof over our house. When I called Harry this morning, he said, we just finished taking communion. That's the kind of spiritual father that we can learn something from. It's about taking that time, making time for God, building that roof. We need to build a roof, and prayer builds that roof. Pray, through prayer you're putting a spiritual roof in your house. And I cannot underestimate how powerful that is. When a man steps up and says, family, let's pray together. Family, let's pray. You're putting a spiritual roof over your house. The favor of God will come onto your children and will come onto your home. The protection of God will come onto your family and your home. When together we as a family take a few minutes and we acknowledge God, we have to get back to that, guys. We have to get back to that. We have to put a roof of protection, of spiritual protection over our houses from the onslaught of evil spirits. We can break the curses through prayer. We can break those boundaries through prayer. In Genesis chapter 27, from verse 1 to 29, it talks about how Jacob blessed his son Esau. And he gives us three secrets that I want to break down for you this morning. How to bless your children, how to bless your family, and how to be the leader of your home. It said, first of all, that when he came in and he said, Father, bless me. I want you to put a blessing on me. And the father first said, come to me. And the scripture says that he touched him. He reached out and he touched him. And that's the first blessing that we can put onto our kids this morning, is meaningful touch. There's something about a father who will touch his children, who will hug his children, who will kiss his children, who will embrace them and give them meaningful touch. And sometimes as men, as our children get older, especially, I think sometimes it doesn't really matter, boys or girls, it might feel a bit awkward. And we're brought up in, especially in this country and in this generation, where that's just not cool. Like, we don't do that. But I'm sure you've noticed that here in church, obviously not now with this whole coronavirus going on, we like to hug one another, shake hands. There's something that happens when you lay hands on one another. It's something that happens when we have meaningful touch with one another. You actually, if you put your hand on the person next to you right now, God made us that way. That meaningful touch, you'll actually see that person's pupils dilate. You'll see their blood pressure drop. Everything seems to just fall away. And that happens when we hug one another, when we embrace one another. And it's easy for us to say, oh, my dad never did that. You know, we weren't a huggy, kissy sort of family. We didn't do that. I was blessed enough to have a dad that when we didn't see each other, especially in the last years of his life, when we didn't see each other, he would kiss me. Proud and unashamed. And I think that's all we need to do, guys. It doesn't matter how big your kids are. I love kissing my boys. I love kissing my boys. I can't get enough. Sometimes I'll say, I love you so much, I just want to eat you up. We need to be huggy, kissy parents. We need to be unashamed. The Bible shows us that they touched one another. We need to touch our kids, meaningful touch. Life is too short, guys. We need to reach out and we need to touch them. We need to kiss them. They love it. Even though sometimes they're like, I mean, my little boy Levi's four. And he asked him to come give me a kiss. He says, no. He's just, he'll tell you straight, no. And even though they'll tell you no, they love it. They love it. When you kiss them, they love it. Reach out and touch your family. It does something. It does something on the inside. It does something on the inside of us when we touch one another. Meaningful touch. It's been proven medically. I know we see it a lot in the nursing homes, that when they bring dogs and cats in and they allow the elderly to touch the dogs and the cats, it's been proven that it brings out something, it reinvigorates something inside of those elderly people. You see it a lot with kids that are disabled and kids with autism, with horses as well. That they, when they touch horses, that meaningful touch. I mean, when a horse is a big animal, but I don't know if any of you, if you lay your ear against the horse's side of his body there, you can actually hear their heartbeat. And it's about, even when you've got a little baby at the back there, it's when we take that little baby and, you know, you lay that baby onto your chest, that baby can hear your heart beating. When we embrace one another, when we embrace our kids, we can hear the heartbeat. And God wants us to embrace Him in prayer. He wants us to embrace Him so that we can get so close to Him. I preached this a few weeks ago. We talk to God to reach other people. When we reach somebody in the street, when we speak to somebody, we could be the closest thing to Jesus that they would ever see. And it's when we get into that place of prayer, when we're putting that spiritual roof over our houses, that God can, we can get into a place where we can hear His heart beating. And it's when we get into that meaningful touch, even with our Father God, that we can start building that spiritual upliftment in our kids. Meaningful touch, guys. We need to be more touchy. We need to be more feely. We need to be more huggy. We need to be more loving. Because you know what the scary thing is? One day those kids won't be there anymore. One day we won't be there anymore to do it. One day we won't be there anymore. I heard this morning, Rabbi Zacharias, you guys, I don't know if you guys know of him. His daughter was speaking. I think it might have been at his funeral. And just speaking, she was saying that she spoke to her 8-year-old. While Ravi was really sick, he had cancer. And the little boy, I think it was a little boy, the little boy said that, what am I going to do when Papa's gone? That's the question that this little 8-year-old asked her mother. What am I going to do when Papa's gone? That relationship, guys, that we build with those kids as dads and as grandparents and even as spiritual fathers in those kids' lives. I'm going to tell you a story just now, we'll get to that, but about being spiritual fathers. But that relationship, we only have a limited time. We have a limited time to install our knowledge, to install our love, to give those kids that meaningful touch. So the blessings, Dad, begin with hugs and kisses. And the Bible says that not only did he touch him, and not only did he kiss his son. And I mean, his son was already 20. If we read in the scripture, we surmise that he's about 20 years old. And there's nothing wrong with that, guys. We need that now in this day and age more than ever before. And secondly, he spoke a verbal blessing over his child. He began to bless him. The word blessing means to attach a high value to that person's life. When we speak about blessing your family, it means that you attach a high value. You speak future-orientated words and blessing over their lives. You speak a bless, and you speak and you bless them for the future. You talk about a good talent or a gift or something that God's installed inside of them. And you say, man, you're amazing. Man, you're a champion. You're going to do something great, and I believe in you. And you can do anything that you put your mind to. I look at you playing that guitar at the age of 16. I wish I had the opportunity to play guitar at the age of 16. Because by the time you're my age, you're going to be a rock star, buddy. We need to speak that into one another's lives. We need to tell those kids there's nothing. There is absolutely nothing that you cannot do. You could say, well, yeah, you can do this, you can do that. Well, I wouldn't be surprised if you had a talent or you could do that. We need to say, you're talented. You're gifted. God's put something on the inside of you. And what are we doing? We're speaking future-orientated blessings into those kids' lives. We need to begin to position them. Kids are so impressionable. I just said that they're like sponges and they take on everything, and it's our responsibility to build them up. Our words, guys, begin to direct them in a direction. We need to continually affirm the future of our children. Jesse said something at the beginning of service, and while I was preparing, I was sitting here yesterday and I was preaching the sermon to nobody. Well, I believe the Holy Spirit was in the room. I was preaching the sermon, and God put on my heart that I need to touch on that same subject this morning about unforgiveness. I think it's something we so easily, that so easily ensnares us in our lives. Unforgiveness with our parents, and I know it's Father's Day, I'm not only directing it at parents, I'm not only directing it at dads, I'm directing it at moms too. If you have any unforgiveness in your heart, and I believe that the Holy Spirit would lead me as I just, guys, I want to, if there's anybody in this room this morning, there might be one of you in my room. But if you have any unforgiveness in your heart, and unforgiveness can come from a very, very long time ago, I'd just like us all just to close our eyes. And I'd like to pray, Holy Spirit, Lord Father God, if we have any inch, any thread of unforgiveness in our hearts this morning, won't you reveal it to us? Won't you reveal it to us, Lord, as we're in the house of God this morning? Let us pull off that scab and let us allow the blood of Jesus to flow. It's through your blood that the healing comes. Holy Spirit, I pray that that unforgiveness that might have taken root so many, many years ago will be set free this morning. Lord, we pray for your forgiveness, for our unforgiveness. Lord, we pray for forgiveness from our fathers. We pray for forgiveness from our mothers. We forgive them this morning. Lord, heal us. Set us free. The power is not in us, but the power is in you. You're a chain-breaking, miracle-working God. God, set them free this morning. Set us free. Positive attributes in our kids. Not the negative, and that's something that actually challenges me. We need to point out the positive. It's easy always just to reprimand and to stop doing this, especially with us two. Listen, guys, two boys so close together, it's a challenge. And I thank God for his help. But it's challenging, and it challenges me to be able to reprimand them and speak blessing over them at the same time. And there's a fine line, I believe. And I believe the only way that we can draw that fine line is through the power of the Holy Spirit and through the power of Jesus in our lives to show us the way. Narrow is the gate that leads to life. We need to walk down that narrow gate. We need to lead those kids down that narrow path. I heard about a boy who was injured from the birth canal, and there was complications, and he never walked. And he was in high school, and he got very depressed with his circumstances, and he even tried to commit suicide. But there was men at his local church, two men in particular, that got together, and they started speaking a blessing into this child's life, and they began to tell him about how great he was. There was something about his voice. He had a very deep, very strong voice. And they kept on telling him what a beautiful boy voice he had. And you know what? This young boy went on to be a famous talk show host. And those men at that time didn't even realize what they were doing. And what they were affirming in him. They were speaking a future-orientated blessing into this young boy's lives. The words that we speak can build up, and they can install power into one another. We have to be positive. We have to be positive with our kids. As I said, I'm speaking from my heart a little bit this morning. I've got some notes, but I'm jumping in between. And I believe the Holy Spirit will lead me as I just break away each time. We need to be positive. James Dobson said, for every time you criticize your child, you should give it 7 positive blessings back. That's a challenge. For every time you attack them and criticize them and cut them down, you need to positively affirm back a blessing 7 times. When is the last time that you spoke a powerful, positive word over your kids? We need to be positive. Everyone say, be positive.
Be positive.
Not again. Be positive. If you're going to raise children, we need to speak a word of courage and words of positivity over their lives and tell them how incredible they are and how much they mean to us and tell them how special they are and how great they are. Not only you're stupid and you're no good and you're worth nothing, we can't be speaking those words over our kids' lives. We need to speak words like you're marked by God. You've been called. These are the words we need to say. You have a gift from God in your life. God has a plan and a purpose for each and every one of us. Affirm and encourage and speak life into your house. Speak life over your children. Because, guys, they value your approval. God, dads, moms, your kids value your approval. They value your appreciation. And a lot of times we go through our lives and we're trying to impress our dads, especially in that generation I was speaking about earlier. We live our lives trying to live up to an expectation that was never theirs to put there in the first place. We need to understand that the lives that we need to live up to is the life that this book tells us about. The father that this book installs in each and every one of us. That fatherly figure of Jesus Christ and our good, good father, as we sang this morning in heaven. That fatherly figure is the one that we need to live up to. We can't please man, guys. We can't please man. We'll never be good enough. And we'll never be good enough in our own eyes. But we will be good enough in the eyes of God. And it's in that that we look at the Father and the Father gives us strength. And He will give us approval in our lives. We need to say things like, you're smarter than I would ever be. You can achieve greater things than I can ever achieve. You're amazing. Have I told you how great you are? Guys, there's a value in speaking and uplifting and encouraging our kids. We need to understand that that is fuel to their self-esteem. That's the fuel they need. That's the fuel in their engines. When we begin to speak positive words, we begin to build them up. We need to help them with their relationship with God and to build up their self-esteem. That's what we are called to do. And that's what blessing does. We need to speak positivity. Not always just correcting the wrong. We need to be positive. To turn to the person next to you and tell them, you need to be more positive. You need to be more positive. And the next thing that we have to do is we need to be pliable. We need to be pliable. You know, it's so easy for us to just go with the flow. Just to do the same thing every day, but it's the way we've always done it. But it's the way I was taught. Or it's just what I know. We need to be pliable. We can't be so rigid and so mean. And sometimes even so stuck up all the time. Ephesians 6 verse 4. Fathers or parents, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Don't encourage your children. Don't enrage your children. And don't intrigue them to wrath. Listen, when you start to see an independent spirit in your kids, and I'm starting to see it at 5, and I think Harry said to me, how old are you? 19? Yeah, he's seeing it already. I think it normally typically happens from about the age of 12, 13, 14, 15. We start seeing this independent spirit coming up in our kids. And I want to encourage you this morning that that's God's way of getting them out of your house. So it's not all that bad when they they start getting an attitude, and they start getting independent, and they act like you don't know anything, and they don't want to listen to you anymore. Guys, it's all part of God's plan. A man shall leave his father and his mother, and he shall cleave to his wife. And that goes the same for the girls. And part of that is finding a little independence. And as I said, we need to be pliable. We need to give them a little room to start building themselves up so they're able to get out of the nest. That little bird in that nest needs to flap its wings, doesn't it? It needs to start building muscles. And it's the same that we need to allow kids to build their own independence so that they'll be able to take that leap and soar into the plans and the visions and the prosperity that God has for each and every one of their lives. You know that as you grow up and learn, and as those kids grow up and learn, and they think that we're just so stupid and we don't know anything and we have no idea what they're going through, and all we do is we throw shade on them and we literally just don't understand. We have to understand, they sort of even get this attitude of, you can't understand what I'm dealing with. I know I was there, and I think a lot of us in this room can relate. And it's only as we grow up that we realize how our parents were just trying their absolute best. Because guys, let's just be quite frank about it. There's no rule book. There's no rule book on how to be a parent. The Bible gives us very good guidelines, and thank you Jesus for that. But I think there is a book. It's called What Parenting for Dummies 101 or something like that. But I don't believe it's really going to work. There's no real game plan. We kind of just wing it. And we learn from that legacy, those things that our fathers and our mothers installed in us. Sometimes we have to give our kids a little space to find themselves. We need to give them some allowance and stop being so rigid about everything. We need to find out what's worth fighting over and not make much ado about nothing. Just because you want to dominate, and this is especially for the dads, just because you want to dominate and puff up your chest and show how macho you are, that's not how we do it. That's not how we do it. We need to be pliable. We need to sometimes let them have that hairstyle. We need to let them wear those pants that hang under their bums. We need to let them find themselves. Because I promise you, after a while, he's going to put his pants on. And he'll cut his hair. And he'll take the earrings out. It happens. That's God's way. God will work through them. We need to put that roof up. We need to pray for those kids. We need to be pliable. We don't want all of our kids to be the same. We can't be like, I wish you were more like your brother, or I wish you were more like your sister. We can't be like that. I can't stand people that say, oh, why can't you be more like Pastor so-and-so? Because I don't want to be. Why can't you? We can't make people be like somebody else. You know, your kids don't want to be the same. They don't want to be the same. They don't want to wear the same clothes. They want to be independent. And our responsibility as parents is to keep moral and spiritual boundaries in place. That's our responsibility. We need to give them some latitude. We need to give them some independence. You know, if your kids got a music calling on their lives, or we can't expect our kids to be carbon copies of us. We can't just be like a mommy duck and a daddy duck and all the little quackers following. It doesn't work that way. Life doesn't work that way. Us as humans don't work that way. We need to be independent. I guess what I'm trying to say is we need to lighten up a little. And give them a bit of leeway. We don't want to be like, have you ever seen those Christian parents? They're so mean and they're so ugly and like, shh. Kids can't do that. We don't want to be those. We don't want to be those sort of parents. All that's going to do, guys, is drive those kids away. That's what that's going to do. Leave the non-essential issues alone, and don't make something out of nothing. Men, dads, support your kids. Go to their sporting events. Be there for them. Be on the sideline encouraging them and cheering them on. You might not want to go to that ballet recital or that piano rehearsal, but go. You're all that that child has. Your attention matters. Your attention matters. Guys, go to that school play. Even if your kid just runs on and you wait there for 3 hours, your kid runs on and smiles at you with two teeth in their mouth and waves. Even if that's all you see, that's priceless. That's priceless. Go to the games. Even if your kid's on the third team and sitting on the bench, he can see you on the stands from the bench. You're all that he has. It matters, guys, it matters. David says when he took the Ark of the Covenant back to the temple, the Bible says in 2 Samuel 6:20, when David returned home to bless his household. It's one thing to have the presence of God in church, but it's another thing, what would happen if each and every man would walk out of here this morning having the presence of God walk out with him? Having the presence of God walk home with you, and you open your mouth and you start praying. What would happen if each and every one of us could put a spiritual roof over our houses as of this morning on Father's Day? What's the day? Is that? 21st. The 21st of June in the year of 2020. What would happen if each and every dad and each and every mom would understand that I am the priest of my home? And I bless my children. And God's hand is upon my life. And God's going to do something. And the Lord's going to acknowledge you and your home this morning. It's not good enough just to go to church to where the presence of God is. We're supposed to take the presence of God home with us and bless our homes. Joshua said at the age of 110, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I don't care what's happening in the world around me. I don't care what's happening at that party down the street. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. God, make us a Joshua generation. Make us men that are more like Joshua. Give us men who are determined to raise their families for God. Men who say, I'm involved with my kids. I am part of my kids' life. Men, be involved in your families. That's my challenge to you this morning. Be involved. Todos para familias, Portuguese means everything for the family. Everything for the family. Men, be involved. Fight for your family time. Fight for your kids. Fight to put that roof on your family. There is nothing more important. I'm almost done. In 1924 in Paris, in the Olympic Games, there was a man named Bill Havens. And Bill was on his way to go and compete in the Olympics. And he was a shoo-in to take the gold medal. It was a given. He has been practicing for years and years and years, and he knew how to tame those whitewater rapids in the canoe. Everybody, the Olympic Committee, his family, they knew he would stand on that podium at the end of that Olympic Games. And as he got onto the plane, his phone rang, and his wife had gone into labor. And he shocked not only his wife, but the Olympic Committee when he got off the plane. He said, I will be there when my first child is born. He went to the hospital. He missed the Olympic Games. And his infant son, Frank, was born into the world on the first, on August 1st, 1924. And though Bill always wondered how it would be to have stood up on that podium and have that gold medal hang around his neck, he never regretted the decision that he made on that day to get off of that plane. Bill loves Frank. Bill loved Frank so much that he installed absolutely everything he could into that young man. And he shared every bit of knowledge about the rapids and about canoeing into Frank's life. He taught him how to canoe the rapids, and 24 years went by, and the Olympic Games were held in Helsinki, Finland. This time Frank Havens, this is the son, qualified to compete in those Olympic Games. And the day after the Olympics, Paul received a telegram from his dad that read, "Dear Dad, thank you for waiting around for me to be born in 1924. I'm coming home with the gold medal that you so much desired." What that father decided was that there were things that could not be reached, and that he could not reach and that he could not achieve. But if he could pour into his son could go even further than he had ever dreamed of going. What I'm saying to you this morning, men, don't neglect your homes. Let's not neglect our families. Let's not neglect our children. There is no higher calling on your life than to be the father or the mother of your family. And there is nothing more powerful than when a family unites and says, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." So my prayer today for every dad is that you will be positive and you will be pliable. That you will lighten up a little. And that you would love those kids. That you would bless them with meaningful touch. And you would bless them with verbal blessings. And the third one this morning is we need active commitment. We need to be actively committed dads. When we find out that those children have a gift, we don't just say good luck with that and let them go along. When we come up under them and we help them, and we help them to get training, and we help them to get those extra classes, and we get them that music teacher, do what you can do. Guys, men, fathers, moms, dads, do everything that you can do. And it's not too late. It's not too late. If you haven't been there, you can still be there. You can still be there. It's never too late. Invest in your kids. And that's the way that we bless our families. We speak and we be positive. We be pliable and we lighten up a little. We need to be playful. We need to play with our kids. Love and enjoy those children. These are years, ladies and gentlemen, that you'll never get back. Let's be better dads. Let's be better parents to our kids. Amen. Can we close our eyes? Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are in our midst this morning. Lord, we thank you for this word today. We pray that it will open up our hearts, Lord, that we would be able to pour out into our kids. Lord, as we prayed earlier, we let go of that unforgiveness in our hearts. Let's reconcile those relationships. I pray that even as we walk out of here this morning, that some men or women would phone their dads without even expecting a response. Just say sorry. Just say, "I forgive you." Say, "I ask for your forgiveness." Let's reconcile those relationships before it's too late, guys. Before it's too late. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you, and make his face shine upon you, be gracious unto you, and lift up his countenance towards you and give you peace and protection and blessing and help. Lord, be with my friends, be with each and every person in this room. Draw them closer to you even this morning.